Right, so you did the backside of the sword?
Yes, very simple. Just a letter edge here to mm-hmm. this side with a small reflex here.
Yeah.
Quite dark here. I just painted it in a lighter blue and glazed with some tank brown over it
mm-hmm.
to also give it a nice little red brown impact. Same as I did here.
Yeah. So that's another part we just finished off cam. And there's a lot of more metal parts to come. The basic principle is always the same.
Yes. And as it was really so repetitive, as it's like the same kind of detail on here.
Yeah.
We just decided to do that off cam.
Mm-hmm.
We will continue with the non-metal parts and.
The awesome backpack. All right. So is the whole thing going to be metal, or is it just the application that's metal?
It's going to be metal overall, but different kind of metal. So right. We also have the steel and some gold going on, and I want to add some color variation here around the exhaust, where we have the heat. Changing the color of the metal.
Nice. All right.
All right. So
we'll probably do one, and you'll do the other one off cam. Or are you going to do it at the same time?
I think I will do at least the silver part. I want the underlying layer to be silver here mm-hmm. in here to have some color variation, and the upper part to be gold. And I think I will do the blue here at the same time, just to mm-hmm. have the same kind of level in there. And do just one gold and finish the other one off,
okay? Okay, sounds like a plan.
Okay, so I remixed some of that blue. And we just try to keep some of the black in the recesses to have a nice frame towards the gold.
I think one thing that you're doing right now is that's very new to many of people watching this video, is that typically you would go and kind of base coat the whole thing, let's say blue or whatever, and then you might add a wash to kind of get the dark lining, the separation to the individual sides back. You probably do your silver, and then you would start the gold on top of that. Ben works a little differently. He really likes to paint area by area, and where he can also keep the original dark line from, in this case, the base coat on the black foundation, and really works from area to area. So I think that's just by the approach is just very different from what many of you guys out there know. As you see, it's not really slower or anything. It just has more control.
Yeah, and as the wet and wet technique and also the loaded brush is just really happening where you're working with the brush at this very moment. So it's a very locally
confined area.
Yeah. Okay, one thing we have to keep in mind is our the direction of the light.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided the light to come from here. So we also need the stronger reflex on that side of the cylinder.
Yeah. And that's obviously something that miniature painting is not 100% consistent. Like when you look at it from the front, you usually have the light somewhere to the front and the top right. And then when you're looking at the back, everything in theory should be in shadow, but of course only in theory. we're basically choosing the same light situation on the back. Again, the light comes from the front of the back, if you want, and to the top right. Just a little trick.
Okay, so I'm mixing a light blue. Not pure white, but quite light. To draw in a line where I want the highlights to go. So I think it would be nice if we would be just running around here. Okay, we went a little overboard on that second backpack, but it's not a big problem. Okay, and now with the middle tone between the two, just softening it out to the sides. And with that middle tone in the brush, you just add some white to the tip to increase the highlight.
And you just saw that there was actually quite a bit of white on the brush, and Ben just put it on his, a little bit of that on his finger to reduce the amount. And again, this is something that comes with experience. It looks a little weird right now because it's still separated by those black areas. But as soon as the gold is painted and you have the same kind of highlights and reflexes on there, it'll make more sense. And it's still already, actually already looks pretty good. That will even be better.
Okay. A little darker here to the side.
And again, that's metal. A lot of contrast going on very small distances.
Okay. So in the next step, I would just take some black to the side here of the transition on the palette, tone it just down with a little bit of the gray, and take that very dark color again to paint over the raised parts, and also to get a nice clean separation line between the elements.
Yeah, it's almost impossible to avoid touching those a little bit.
Yeah, especially as they are quite deep actually.
Which is nice that they are so deep.
Yep. Okay, we can see one advantage of the depth actually in 1 second, because we can when we paint the gold, we can just use the side of the brush to achieve some of the blending. So this is the mid-tone from the Japanese uniform.
So Japanese uniform with a little black, or?
Yeah.
We actually talked about this a little bit off cam, that we are using a different recipe, if you want, for gold now. We always had one color that was the color for the last 10 years. Which one was that then?
Oops. So yeah, one color a lot of people used for non-metal is the famous Snake Bite Leather by Games Workshop.
Yeah.
But as that color is out of production, we look for a substitute color for that. And actually, the Japanese uniform is quite nice because it's not that yellow and not that saturated. So it gives a more, I would say, a even more realistic non-metal gold.
Yeah, I completely agree. And I would say that I think this new kind of gold is a little bit more modern. I personally particularly like this greenish component in it. One of the things you can kind of see here a little bit that I think we've shown extremely well on the Papa Jumbo video for Big Child Creatives, the Black Sailor campaign, is this, that you can actually use one color and you don't change that color at all and already create blendings on a black surface. Ben actually used the same color like on two or three different layers, but didn't touch all of the areas. So like the first one, of course, on black is a little darker. Then he paints a little smaller area, and then the sides are already darker than the middle, and then a little more in the middle. And that turns even brighter. And that's actually a very, very quick way to start doing some really cool blendings with almost no work. Yeah, now, of course, he goes and puts the highlights in. A lot of our supporters for the Painting Buddha Academy tell us that they're watching sometimes the same video 2, 3, 4 times, even like with a little time lag in between. And because, of course, there's a lot of stuff happening right now, and especially if you're new to the little more like high-level painting or even a little bit of showcase painting, there's just a lot of information. But I think it's good for every level. Will your first measure like this? Maybe not, but your third might.
Yeah, your third should look like that. No, but
should look at least get closer.
Yeah, definitely. Because I think really what we mentioned before, getting used to a lot of new techniques will just make your painting at the beginning look not as nice as before.
Yeah,
but. Always stay open-minded and try out different things.
Yeah.
I mix a darker color here to get some blending done towards the sides here.
We always get the question, like, what kind of level is our DVD or what kind of level is our videos? And really there for every level. I want to even say that somebody who's never painted before may have the best benefit because they're learning. I wouldn't say learning things right because there's many, many different ways of painting exactly. Miniatures. Okay. But they're learning a way from scratch that is at least not the worst. So Ben is pretty good. But if you've already painted 15 years and never diluted your paints, that might already cause... a learning curve in the beginning.
Yeah, I also think for a lot of experienced painters, it's also very interesting to see how other painters actually work.
Yeah.
Because, for example, even if I do miniature painting now for years, I haven't seen even some of my closer miniature painting friends actually work for hours and hours, because you never have that time, and on an event you talk about different stuff. And
yeah.
So even for me, watching these DVDs or sitting on the other side of the table and filming, for example, with people like Kirill,
David Zabrowski, you filmed them.
Yeah.
Matt, you filmed even. But with Matt, you're also painting a little bit.
Yeah, quite a bit.
Quite a bit offline, so to speak. And as Ben said, that he's using this technique now for about a year and a half, maybe two. And we've been working in painting Buddha longer than that. So I can see that even he picks up new stuff. And I think miniature painting is also evolving all the time. It's, I mean, right now, textures are like a big subject, for example. And the Kirill video, for example, is insane. He's not blending. He's just making textures, and that creates blending. It's really cool. I think this is where another element comes in. Of course, there's, we're talking a lot of technique, but then on non-metallic metal, you kind of have to know where the lights are. And now, if you're following this along, you probably don't have to think about it, because you just put it exactly where Ben put it, and you'll be fine. But if you're doing something on your own, of course, you can reference a video like this. You can try to find like metallic objects on Google that have a similar shape, these kind of things.
Yeah, and also I think it's always good when you paint non-metal, you always have to think about the let's say the basic shape of the object itself and how it would reflect the light. So we have here the cylinder with a rounded top.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to paint a straight line for the cylinder as a reflection line, and a somewhat round reflex on the top.
Mm-hmm.
Darker here to the sides.
This and there's a loaded brush and wet and wet going on right now, and this wet and wet technique might also be difficult for someone who's just glazed all his life. Because you're doing like your stroke, then you're blowing and waiting till it dries, and then you're doing the next stroke, and like half an hour later you got your blending. But that was, for example, for me. Here you have to be a little faster, because you still want the paint to be wet when you start working on the surface.
Yeah, but what I noticed is that a lot of people are afraid that the color actually dries faster as it actually does. Because you think, oh no, I have to work very fast to achieve my blending.
Yeah.
But actually you have quite a bit of time, and if you just focus on a small area like that here, you have not all the time in the world, but you have quite a bit of time.
Yeah.
I will take some tank brown to frame the little rivets on top here. Actually, I'm just going to paint over them to line them.
I didn't even see that one. I can see. And now you see why a good tip is so important. I mean, with any kind of non-tip brush, this is almost impossible. But hitting that little rivet.
Okay, and a little bit more diluted tank brown. Also here to glaze that into the shadows.
Yeah. Creating the same or similar effect with metallic paints is actually much harder than with non-metallic paints. And there's a certain scale when non-metallic paints kind of stop to work. I'd say like 54 millimeter is kind of a good scale still for non-metallics. 75 can be, but that's kind of where you want to start thinking about doing true metal. As a rule of thumb, of course, there's exceptions and you can do whatever you want, but...
Yeah, I think the one thing that you have to keep in mind is that it will just... look like different in style.
Yeah,
and I think non-metal is very nice for more for that fantasy sujet than actually for historic topics.
Sure,
it
yeah.
looks always a bit more cartoony, and you can also work on a very grim and dark non-metallic, but that is also a lot of work because you have to work a lot with textures to make it look more realistic. Okay, and in that line here, so a stronger reflection on that rim.
You can actually see how quickly that little part looks like metal just with two lines. Very, very strong highlights.
And so the original yellow. And even painting like quite a strong reflex down here is so important to get a believable metallic look over the whole surface.
Mm-hmm. Again, I think we are, as I mentioned earlier, we're probably addressing more gamers than painters right now. And some of you might think, oh my God, I'm never going to be able to do this. I just want to tell you one very short story. We had somebody who painted Horus. Yesterday we heard about this, Horus the War Master. And he was almost done and then found our video about Horus the War Master and the Academy. And then he painted it again. And all I can say is that thing looked, I would say, almost as good as Ben's, if not almost the same. Like the armor itself,
yeah, the armor was perfect, really, really good.
Yeah, and there was it was a big difference in the before and after if you think about it, and that's the nice thing about these videos. If you just take your time, don't rush it, focus on it step by step along the way, you'll get to these kind of results.
Okay, I think one thing that we should mention is it's important to have the right balance between the main highlight that results from the shape of the object and the mm-hmm. light source, and all these little reflections that you have from the ornament itself. So it's just small white reflexes on the upper part of the edge here.
Yeah.
And those are so important to really have the raised parts stand out a bit more and make them look extra sharp.
Yeah. I mean, just even if you just had one base coat of the uniform, the Japanese uniform on there, and would just do those little raised areas, that alone already looks like metal. Now, of course, if you then have some changes and blendings in the metal, it helps even more. But those little things basically make it metal.
Yeah. Actually, I think this here is quite a nice point already.
Mm-hmm.
I will continue with the other side off cam, and we'll be back to get in a little color variation due to the heat.
Okay.
All right.
All right. So you got the second one finished, basically the same as the first one.
Yep.
And what is next?
Next, before we do the color variation on the exhaust, I think it would be good to actually paint the frame.
Mm-hmm.
To have that part already painted before we work with the colors in here.
Yeah. So this is also metal. You're going to do a different
hue
or something?
I will do also a steel-colored metal.
Mm-hmm.
But with a little bit more scratches because the surface gets bigger, and I think that part would be quite used actually.
Mm-hmm.
So only a little bit different, but still I think it's very interesting to see how the same effect looks with a little bit more scratches.
Okay.
Also, I think the especially the shape up here is quite nice actually to highlight that and show how we work with short transitions
mm-hmm.
to achieve that non-metal look.
So it's the same base color as used for the other?
Yeah. So okay, first just painted the one side. You can still see it's still a little bit wet. We need to let that dry.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have to think actually about where our main highlight on that upper part will be. And that will actually be here on the top side of the other one.
Yeah.
Of this side, we have the reflex here as well.
Mm-hmm.
So we can draw that in just to have a orientation point.
And it's really important to be consistent with the light sources of all of the miniature, but in particular also for non-metallic metals, because if they're like all over the place, it looks really weird.
Okay, so that is like the strongest light that we have on that side.
Mm-hmm.
And so we know, pretty sure that we have to be a little darker on that on the other side. Plus, I want always the dark side facing the light side on the touching part. So that would mean our light would be down here. A bit darker to get the transition up here. Clean the brush and feather it out over the surface.
Yeah. So you can see it's actually quite simple. The transition is still a little.
Yeah.
It's not transitioning. We'll do this again. Slide, please. Yeah. There's really two reasons to wait until the paint is dry. First of all, only when it's dry you can really see the effect of the transition, because if it's wet it always looks a little too shiny. And secondly, of course, you don't want to pull any paint off that you've already painted if it's not dry.
So the next highlight should be here on top of that round element. We need to solve that out to both sides. It's a little hard to reach for me here under the cam. But for you at home, it's even a bit easier.
I would say that's definitely a skill that Ben has picked up in all of his filmings. It's how to reach areas that you usually would not show to the camera when you're painting them.
So I want to increase the highlight here a bit.
Also, these are very small distances Ben is currently blending, but always note the direction of the brush. That if you're painting a highlight color, you're trying to move towards the highlight. If you're painting a shadow color, you're trying to move the brush towards the shadow. So you push the pigments where they need to be.
Yeah, it's a little bit too broad here where I wanted to highlight the edge. I'm just quickly taking some of that middle tone.
Yeah, it's nice. Very nice.
Okay, so areas like that, you really have to pay quite some attention to the sculpt itself and how it would catch the light. So here we have another little surface. Here, as this is actually, if the figure is standing upwards, that would have just a tiny transition because it's more or less upright.
Mm-hmm.
So I'll try to lighten this part and maybe add some tiny scratches, but get more effect on the surface by the tiny scratches than by a huge transition from light to dark. First, a small transition. Mixing a lighter blue on the palette. And just little lines on the surface. Towards the edge. And as that is quite strong, I will just glaze it a little over it with the mid-tone.
Mm-hmm. I'll take those highlights off a little bit.
Yeah, to just bind the surface a bit more together.
Yeah. And that's basically how you do that part.
Yes.
Yeah.
And yes, the other side will be the very same, just a bit brighter, mm-hmm. and starting from the light point here.
Mm-hmm.
But that will be very much the same, and we don't want to bore you guys. I will continue with that, and we will be back for the
metal discoloration.
Yep.
All right.
All right. Cool.
Nice. So yeah, the metal plate is the mounting plate is finished. You put a lot of scratches on there.
Yeah, you can see this side is quite a bit lighter.
Mm-hmm. Because it's in the light.
Yeah, I think it's quite nice to see if you compare it just from the very top.
Yeah, it turned out really nice. I wasn't 100% sure how it's going to look with because it's the same color, but it looks really cool. And I think the reason is that it's a flat item, and it's not a round item. So it's just the nature of the reflexes that make it look different.
Cool. Okay, so the
discoloration.
I added tiny amounts of color here to the palette. You can see this here is scruff green from game color.
Mm-hmm.
I thinned that down quite a bit to have a thin glaze. It's a color that is somewhere in between turquoise and green.
Yeah. Do you have a little black in there as well?
No, it's just okay. Pure.
It's not. It doesn't look that saturated. Ah, actually, there's no. I can see it on the palette. On the palette, on the on the whatchamacallits exhaust, I guess.
Yeah, you can see it a lot better on the light parts.
Yeah, we actually went in the break between filming. We went to Google and looked at references of exhaust pipes and heat discoloration. That's exactly the words we used for the search. And it's actually quite interesting. I mean, there's all kinds of different. You can basically do whatever you want, I guess. But green, purple, yellow, those colors were very dominant in the discoloration. Yeah.
Already adds a lot of interest, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And a little bit of purple. Same consistency, so rather thin, and we will just place that here in the low part.
Actually, one of the just while you do this, one of the design considerations we did with this backpack, if you look at the original artwork, it's completely golden. And we decided to kind of separate the two metals. I think this is, for the miniature, it adds a lot of interest and a lot of detail. Looks much, much nicer. If it was just all gold, I think that would not look
so good. Yeah, in the concept, actually, the plate underneath looked a little bit bigger. And I don't know, I think we indicated even a little bit of wood there.
Mm.
But with the sculpt, we just had to make slight adjustments here. Because the area here is quite dark, so yep. And small, so we just kept that in dark color, have the metal frame. That's what we decided also to change the color slightly.
Mm-hmm.
We'll also add a tiny bit of white to the purple. To light up the lower edge here. Get a bit of the scruff green.
Get that back a little bit in some parts.
Also adding a bit of white to the tip.
Well, it's really cool. Very nice.
I like the effect. All right.
And with that?
With that, the backpack is completed.
Nice.
And yeah, I think it looks really fantastic. Also together with the sword.
Yeah.
And the gold over there.
There's one thing I asked you in the break. That is, usually we recommend that you paint a miniature inside to out. That means, like we've done here, the armor is kind of the most inside piece of clothing, if you want,
yeah,
that he wears. And then you do the sash, and then you do the cloak, and so on. And the reason for that is that you don't run the danger of actually touching something you've already painted.
Yeah.
Now, on the back, you've done it differently, because the... We wanted to use the gold on the palette, but here you said that
it's quite easy actually to get access to the powder of the cloth here.
Yeah,
and that is quite easy also here, because it's quite 3D.
Yeah, so it's raised enough to
actually, it's raised enough, and yeah, you can see this here, touch everything here quite nicely. Yeah. So that is not a problem at this point.
Mm-hmm.
I think as the next quite important piece, we will paint the face and also the hands, because mm-hmm. the face is quite deep in there.
Yeah.
So I want to do this, and yeah, let me rearrange the palette for that.
All right, cool.